The first time I saw him was the day he rode into Jerusalem, with people dragging palm leaves before him. You remember, it was the day everyone was so excited. Well, it certainly looked more interesting than the marketing I was doing. I asked one of the women with him, "Who is this man? Why are people so excited?" She smiled and said, "His name is Jesus. They are so excited because he is the Messiah." She said it as calmly as she might have said he was the new town magistrate. "The Messiah, do you believe that?" She said, "Yes, I believe I do. I know I love him." "He is your husband?" "Oh no," she said with a twinkle. "He is my teacher." Again, I was shocked. What kind of woman was this, openly declaring love for a man not her husband, and who had never heard of a woman student? Women weren't students. Women were wives, at least good women were. This was no place for a respectable woman. I turned to leave. "Don't be afraid," the woman said gently. "Come listen to him." And surprising myself, I went with her. When he saw her, he smiled and called out, "Mary, I was afraid I lost you." Then he turned and smiled at me, looking right into my eyes. It was an amazingly brazen thing to do, looking right at a woman to whom he was not related. I should have looked away, lowered my eyes, covered my face. After all, I am a married woman. But I didn't look away. I couldn't. My eyes met his, and everything changed. Suddenly, I was seen, acknowledged and valued and honored and, yes, beloved. For the first time in my entire life, I knew I was somebody who mattered. Me. All by myself. Not my father's daughter, not my husband's wife, not my son's mother. Me. I was transfixed. Then the crowd surged forward. In seconds, I lost sight of him. I tried to follow, but the throng was too thick. And finally, my maid's frightened pleadings persuaded me to return home to Bethany. But once home, I could not forget him, or that wonderful sense of being recognized and valued. I later heard he upset moneylenders' tables in the temple courts. It was a huge scandal, and people were beginning to mutter that such meddlers would get us all into trouble. Then I learned that he was in a house here in Bethany, at the home of Simon the leper. The instant I heard that, I knew what to do. On impulse, I scooped up the vial of oil I saved for the most special of occasions. My maid was staring at me, wide-eyed. "Come along," I said, and swept out of the house, sure she wouldn't disobey. I hurried through the dim, narrow streets, a bit disoriented, for I rarely was out after dark. And when I was with my husband and followed him. But tonight, I was the leader. This man, Jesus, had deeply honored me. Now I wanted to honor him. Somehow, we found the right street and the right house. I told my maid to wait outside. And without hesitation, I walked through the gate and right into the room. It was the first time in my life I had walked unaccompanied into a room full of unrelated men. Oh, there were women there too, but they were obviously public women. Part of my mind was screaming, "Get out of here. Your family will disown you. Your husband will divorce you." But the other part of my mind was totally focused on him. I walked straight up to him. He was a tall man, but seated, his head reached only to my heart. I didn't say a word. I simply broke the seal on the small alabaster jar and poured the sweet oil onto his head. The fragrance of even that tiny amount of nard filled the air, and Jesus smiled up at me. As the distinctive odor reached the others, conversations broke off. Suddenly, the room was in an uproar, with men demanding, "What's the reason for this waste? Why, that oil could have been sold and the money given to the poor. It would have brought 300 denarii." I shrank from their anger and would have fled, but his voice silenced them. "Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? This is a beautiful thing she has done for me. As for the poor, you can do good to them whenever you wish. The poor you will always have with you. You will not always have me." Then he looked at me again and I shivered, for suddenly I knew what I had done. "She has done what was in her power to do," he said. "She anointed my body for burial. Truly, I assure you, wherever throughout the world the gospel is proclaimed, what she has done will be told in memory of her." I turned my dazed eyes on him. What was this? My name proclaimed throughout the world? I should have been ashamed, acting like such a public woman. I should have rushed home, hidden myself away, begged my husband's forgiveness. But instead of leaving, I stayed. Instead of shame, I felt honored and beloved. I stayed and listened and learned. I've never forgotten him, and he told them never to forget me. But they have. How sad for them.
My family sent me to work as a scullery maid in the house of the high priest Caiaphas. I was very lucky to have that position, even though I was only 11 years old. My family, they were poor and of no significance, but my mother was determined to do the best she could for me. The cousin of the sister of the aunt of the high priest cook was from our village, and so my mother gathered up all the courage she had and went and negotiated that position for me. Cook was kind to me most of the time, but the house had been upset for several weeks because of somebody called Jesus, and this made Cook cross. Cook said some people thought he was the Messiah. The Messiah? I was thrilled and determined to see him. I began to ask around, but all I heard were rumors, and the house was awash with rumors. The one rumor was that he had brought the dead back to life, that he had healed a leper, and that he had even touched and stopped the blood flow from a sick woman and hadn't even purified himself after touching her. It was all very shocking, but none of it was any help to me. Then I heard that Jesus often stayed in a house in Bethany. The very next day, I went there, even though I had never traveled that far by myself. There was a great crowd of people sitting around this man, and I wormed my way up to the front when I saw him sitting there. He was talking in a low voice to all the people there. Someone said the seated man was Jesus. I have to admit I was disappointed. I expected the Messiah to be highly robed like the high priest. But this man was dressed like my father, a poor working man. Then I began to listen like the others. He was talking about how important we all are and how we each have the power to decide whether we believe. I liked him. He had a really kind face. For the most part, the people with him looked as poor as he did. One woman was making a fuss, and he told her to quit working and to sit down and listen to him like her sister. Can you imagine that, telling a woman to sit amongst the men and listen? I was shocked. That is certainly a revolutionary idea. And indeed, as I looked around, I was pleasantly surprised to see how many women were among his followers. Amongst the followers was one really big man who kept stirring things up and almost arguing with Jesus. Jesus called this man Peter. Finally, I didn't dare stay any longer, but I needn't have worried, as cook would not have missed one little maid. She was very busy right in the middle of her Passover preparations, and the high priest was having several very important people over to confer about Jesus and these troublemakers. I knew what was up for Jesus. I was so worried I couldn't sleep. My restlessness awoke cook, and so I asked her if they would hurt this Jesus. She said, "Oh no, child, I don't think so. But the high priest is responsible for the whole community, and Jesus is making the Romans nervous." "What will they do to him?" I asked. "Not much, probably," she said. "They say he doesn't follow the law, but then again, a lot of people don't. But he's being very public about it. The high priest can't condone that sort of behavior. But I don't think anyone would hurt the man. The Romans will probably just lock him up until Passover is over, when his followers go back to Galilee." At least that's what cook told me, and that's what she believed. But the very next night, I heard that Jesus had been arrested and was in our house, and that the high priest Caiaphas and others were going to sit in judgment of him. The courtyard was filled with people who had clearly planned on staying a while. They had lit fires against the cool evening and were gathering there for any news. I gathered near a fire to stay warm, and there I saw the man Peter. "I know you," I said, pleased to recognize him. "You were with Jesus, the Nazarene." He scowled at me and snapped, "I have no idea what you mean," and walked away. I watched him in surprise. Then a little while later, I saw him again on the porch. He was with a group of men who were talking about Jesus. Naively assuming that they all felt the way I did about Jesus, I said, "This man is one of them," and pointed to Peter. But again, Peter denied it, and so I began to cry. This time, however, one of the bystanders stood up and said, "But you must be with Jesus. You are one of his company, because you have the accent of a Galilean." But Peter began to curse and swear and answer with an oath, "I do not know the man." Just then, cook's rooster crowed in the darkness. It was an unexpected sound, piercing the quiet like a flaming arrow in the night. Everyone was startled and looked towards the sound. When I turned back, I saw Peter. He looked like a crushed man. He looked broken. Without thinking, I reached out to him and he began to weep. Heartbreaking sounds. I helped him sit and knelt beside him. "Hush," I said, like my mother used to when I was small. "Hush, it'll be all right. I heard Jesus. I heard him say that he loves us all." Peter took my little hand in his big one and we sat together for a while. When cook came to find me, she told me it had been decided to let the Romans deal with Jesus. They were on their way to take him into custody. Peter looked at me alarmed, and I knew what I must do. I motioned for him to follow me, and I hid him in the scullery until the Romans had left. After they were gone, I let him out the back door and watched him walk down the alley. I wouldn't see Peter again for many years. But I did see Jesus one more time. I saw as the Romans led him away at the end of a rope. He looked like the lamb being led to slaughter.
I'll be honest. I wasn't thrilled about uprooting the entire household and moving to some place I'd never heard of. After all, Judea isn't exactly a household word in Rome. But Pontius was elated. It was his first important posting, and he saw it as the first step to bigger and better things. And why not? Pontius is conscientious to a fault, honest and hardworking. So now I was going to have to move our two sons and daughter, our entire staff and our household goods, all the way from Rome to Judea, to the city called Jerusalem. Nothing he told me prepared me for that miserable city. Oh, I don't mean the city is ugly. Parts of it are lovely. But I had never lived anywhere as part of a conquering power. I didn't realize what it means to be considered an oppressor. Every time I went anywhere, Pontius insisted guards accompany me and my maid. The people would look at me out of sullen faces, faces that despised me. It began to bother me more and more, so I began to go out less and less. But even at home, I wasn't relaxed, for while the servants I had hired were good, they clearly were not lovers of Rome. The irony is, of course, that I had less power than most of them. According to Roman law, an unmarried woman remains under the power of her father, and a married woman under the hand of her husband. As a married woman, I'm not even a Roman citizen. Only my husband is. But of course, to the Jews, I was just another part of the occupying force. I tried to stay busy, but I was very lonely. I spent a lot of time on my balcony watching the teeming life of the streets below. I was fascinated by the Jews. Even in the face of Roman power, they never cowered. They might step aside, but they never gave in. Every month or two would bring some new story of rebellion. We heard that Herod's son, also called Herod, had had to kill some crazy man who was running around talking about the end of the world. Pontius said there was some scandal associated with that execution, but he wouldn't tell me what it was. Sometimes men are so irritating. I didn't pay much attention when we began to hear rumors of yet another rabbi, this time from Galilee, who some Jews were beginning to call king or Messiah. I was pregnant again, and I hadn't been sleeping well. When I did sleep, I had troubling dreams. Being a good Roman, I take my dreams seriously. Everyone knows dreams are messages from the gods. The day they arrested that Galilean was a very bad day for me. I was sick all morning, and that night I was a long time falling asleep. And when I did sleep, I dreamed a terrible dream, that that man was brought before Pontius. He looked right into my eyes. I tried to speak, but no sound came from my mouth. I saw my husband condemn him, and then I saw the whole world turn dark. I woke up sweating and sent for Pontius to come to my chambers. "Are you all right?" he asked in concern. I shook my head impatiently. "Please," I said, "have nothing to do with that innocent man. I am upset because of a dream I had about him." But Pontius just smiled and said, "You are upset because of the baby." I pleaded with him, but he gently put me off and left. It was so frustrating. I knew my dream was not just the fancy of a pregnant woman. Later, when Pontius came back, I asked what had happened. He was quiet for a moment, and then he said, "It was so strange. I offered to release the man to them, but they took that notorious prisoner Barabbas instead." So then I asked them what they wanted me to do with the man Jesus. His voice trailed off, and he was looking off into the distance over my head. He didn't say anything for a minute. Then he whispered, "They cried, 'Crucify him, crucify him.'" And I said, "But this man has done no wrong." And still they cried out. The captain of the guard shook my arm and said, "Lord, do something. Make a decision or there will be a riot." I looked at the man Jesus, and he looked back. And then he did the strangest thing. "What?" I asked. He smiled. We sat in silence a moment. I asked, "Then what did you do?" I called for a basin of water, and I said, "I wash my hands of the blood of this innocent man. The responsibility is yours." Then I released Barabbas and ordered Jesus to be whipped and then crucified. I fell back from him. "Oh, Pontius, no! I had no choice, don't you see? But crucifixion. I was no innocent. I had seen the terrible corpses hanging from the crossbeams along the roads. Pontius wouldn't look at me, and I couldn't look at him." We sat in silence for a long time. The room grew dim. When a servant came in to light the lamps, I realized it wasn't night, but mid-afternoon. "Why is it so dark?" I asked. Just then a terrible sound like thunder seemed to shake the earth. I screamed. Pontius leapt to his feet, but we both fell. We lay there holding on to one another, listening to the vast silence that filled the city. Then, slowly, the light came back, and people began moving shakily about. Pontius sat up and pulled me up beside him. Sharp pains were making me gasp. "The baby! Get the midwife," Pontius ordered the maid. He helped me onto the bed and held my hand as I fought against the pain. Everything faded. I was terrified. It was like my dream. Much later, I awoke to find the nurse bending over me. I felt very weak, and before she spoke, I knew the baby was gone. Tears ran down into my hair. And so it was on the same day they took that innocent man down from the cross and buried him. Pontius and I took our innocent baby down the hill and buried him.
Several of us gather at Pilate's house when we hear Jesus has been taken there. Some nearly faint when Pilate sentences him to be crucified. After they lead him away to be flogged, we settle in to wait. Early on, there had been some tension between the women of Jerusalem and the Galilean women. But we soon discovered that our shared love for Jesus erased all differences among us. Mary, the woman from Magdala, became my good friend. It's easy to see why Jesus so obviously loves her. It's equally easy to see why Peter is so jealous of her. Peter, like many of the other men, is unused to having to take women into account in any way. None of the men are as comfortable with us women as Jesus. It was that ease that gave me the courage to approach him that day near Capernaum. I had been bleeding for 12 long years. I had spent all my money on physicians and still I bled. Because the law says a bleeding woman is unclean and any who touch her defiled, my family scorned me and I lived all alone at the edge of town. But I had heard of the wonders Jesus worked. He was in great demand, so I thought, I won't bother him, but if I touch his clothes, I will be well again. So I came up behind him in the crush of people and touched the fringe on his garment. I knew instantly something had changed. My body felt lighter. Then Jesus exclaimed, "Who touched me?" Peter, the man with him, said, "The crowd is pressing upon you. Why do you mean, who touched me?" But Jesus turned and scanned the crowd, insisting, "I felt power go out from me. I want to know who touched me." I was terrified. I hadn't meant to offend. Trembling, I came forward and threw myself at his feet, was I to bleed yet again? But his hand was gentle on mine. As he helped me up, he said, "My daughter, your faith was the source of your healing. Be free and go in peace." I was amazed. He had touched me and had not withdrawn to cleanse himself of the taint of me. A powerful sense of joy filled me. I resolved to follow him wherever I could. I've since tried to model myself after the Magdalene. She warned me people would accuse me of being immoral because we traveled and studied with Jesus. The injustice of it often made me angry, but she just ignored them all with a serene confidence. But now when she heard the news of Jesus's death sentence, she went white to the lips. The grief in her face was terrible to behold. And I'm ashamed to say that the first thought in my head was, what will happen to us women when he is not here? But then I thought, no matter what, I am bound in blood with this man. He made holy the blood that flows through me. And holy is the blood that will be spilled here today.
They're really going to kill this innocent man. Why? He changed my life. He cured me. After 18 years of being bent almost double, 18 years of terrible pain, 18 years of being told it was because I was possessed of demons, 18 years of alternately being shunned and preached at, Jesus set me free. I remember that Sabbath. I had gone to the synagogue to pray. It was usually my only outing of the week, so as to avoid the scorn of the streets. I noticed him teaching when I entered and tried to listen without being noticed. But to my surprise, he called out to me. And then the men standing around him turned and looked at me with disgust. But he smiled and he beckoned to me. And as I began to walk toward him, my fears dropped away. The other men around him drew back. But Jesus didn't shrink away. Instead, he stood up, and to my surprise, he put his hand on me. And it felt so good. No human being had touched me except to shove me or abuse me since I was 11 years old. For that was when my back had started to curve. And by the time I was 12 years old, I was bent over like an old woman. Now, in my 29th year, here was a man touching me with great kindness. If he had done nothing more that day, it would have been more than enough for me. But he didn't stop there. He said, "You are rid of your infirmity." And when he spoke those words, there was like a warmth that flowed through my shoulders and down my spine, and the pain vanished. Then he put his hand under my chin and lifted my face to the sky, and as he did so, I stood up straight. Alleluias rang from my mouth, and I looked skyward for the first time in years. I raised my arms over my head and I praised God, for I knew from whence had come this blessing. But then a synagogue official bustled up, and he was very angry, and he addressed the crowd that had gathered, and said, "There are 6 days each week for manual labor. Come and be healed on one of those days. Do not come on the Sabbath." And then he turned wrathfully on Jesus. And I was horrified. I wanted no harm to come to this man on my account. But Jesus looked at him calmly and said, "How hypocritical. Do you not untie your donkey or your ox and take it for water on the Sabbath day? This woman standing before you, this daughter of Sarah, has been in bondage for 18 years. Why not release her on the Sabbath?" And the officials gathered around were confused. The people and I were not. We were filled with joy and wonder at the words of Jesus. I tried to kneel before him, but he stopped me, holding my hand, and he bent down to me, and what was said then will remain between the two of us. But I will tell you this, I followed this man to Jerusalem, and I know as I watch him take up his cross that I will follow him anywhere, even to Calvary and beyond.
Keening. My heart is in my throat. This is dangerous. The Romans won't appreciate our public grief over the death of a man they've named a criminal. They might arrest all of us too. But these fears last only a second, and my heart fills with admiration for the courage of the other women. I too lift my voice in protest and lament and walk with them behind the soldiers who surround Jesus and his terrible burden. The men have all disappeared, but we women will not leave his mother, and she will not leave him. I can't blame her. I too am a mother. I followed him from southern Phoenicia, and I too will follow him to the death. I am a Greek, by birth a Syrophoenician, by religion a Canaanite. The Jews call me a pagan. I'm a foreigner in their culture, outside their God's covenant, and thus despised. But unlike many of them, I knew from the second I saw him that this was a very special man. He had come quietly to the region of Tyre and Sidon, not wanting anyone to know he was there. But I recognized him as a holy man, and in my great need, threw myself at his feet. "Have mercy on me and my daughter, for she is possessed by a devil," I pleaded. Jesus didn't say anything, but I wouldn't give up. My daughter's life was at stake. I would have stayed there until I died to get help for her. Finally, some of the men with him said, "Give her what she wants. She is shouting at us. She will never go away." Jesus turned to me and said, "Is it fair to take the children's food and throw it to their dogs?" "Yes," I said immediately, "for the dogs eat the scraps that fall from the family table." Jesus smiled at me. "Great is your faith. Be it done as you desire." I leapt up and ran home. When I rushed into my daughter's room, she was sitting up in bed smiling. The demon was gone. In joy, I praised God. Now, as my daughter and I walk along behind him, our grief rings out against the walls of Jerusalem. My daughter gasps as we see him fall. His mother is standing at the turn in the street and her hands reach out just as they must have done countless times when he was an infant learning to walk. He pushes himself up and staggers on. Would that I could give my life to spare his.
I'm standing next to his mother when he sees her. He has risen from his fall and walked only a few steps when he raised his head as if she had called out to him, though she made no sound. I think my heart will break at the look of gentle compassion that appears on his face at the sight of her. She reaches out her hand and touches his cheek, cupping it with that tender gesture of mothers from the beginning of time. Their eyes, so alike, meet and hold. Neither of them weeps, although Mary's entire body looks broken with grief. The soldiers are uneasy, looking away. None of them are very old, and I suspect they can't help but think of their own mothers. Finally, one of them puts his hand on Jesus' back, almost gently, and says in a gruff voice, "Keep moving." His mother's hand falls back to her side, wet with the blood from his face. She looks after him, then slowly puts the reddened hand to her face and licks off the blood, every drop.
Standing with my husband, Simon of Cyrene, wondering what all the noise is about. We have just come into the city and have barely caught our breath, when suddenly a Roman soldier hails my husband. "You," the soldier says, "come here." I am shocked. We are not common people. Simon is an important man in our community in Ethiopia. We have come to worship at the temple, as our people have from the time of Solomon. Why, we list one of Solomon's wives among our ancestors. And this Roman soldier treats my husband like a slave. They grab Simon and pull him into the street. As they do, I see this poor wretch bent under the weight of a crossbeam. The soldiers order Simon to take the beam from him. I am afraid and very angry. How dare they thrust Simon into this mess? Women are crying and carrying on, as if this is an important man, not some common criminal. Simon is the important man, not this other. We are not part of this. But Simon, who can't bear to see a donkey suffer, gently takes the beam from the poor man, saying as he does so, "I will bear your burden for a while, sire." The bloody man lifts his head and nods. Sire? Why on earth would Simon call this criminal sire? But then I see Simon's face, and I know something important is happening. Simon is a proud man, and not given to honoring people without cause. And here he is, bowing to this bloody wreck of a man, as he takes the beam from him. I open my mouth to protest. But Simon, who knows me all too well, looks up and says, "All is well. Come, follow us." Marveling, I do so, wondering how all this will end.
No, I wait for him at my door. I know he will have to pass by here on the way to Golgotha. They all do, all the ones condemned to be crucified. And so I wait, hoping I can give him some tiny bit of comfort. I know they've beaten him. In some awful way, it's Roman kindness. For the weaker he is when they hang him on that cross, the shorter his ordeal will be. I hear the keening of the women long before I see them. The Roman soldiers turn the corner at the bottom of my street, and there he is. A richly dressed black man has been pressed into carrying the crossbeam, probably because the soldiers are afraid Jesus will die before they can kill him. Jesus already is staggering on the steps of the narrow street, and my heart breaks at the sight. As he slowly nears my door, I see in horror that they have put a crown of thorns on his head. Some soldier's idea of fun? The thorns have pierced his scalp and blood courses down his face, nearly blinding him. As the soldiers push past, I remove my veil and shove myself toward him. To my surprise, the soldiers let me through. I bend beside him and put my veil to his face to wipe away the blood. He puts his hands over mine, holding the soft cloth to his face for a few seconds. Then he hands it back to me with a sigh and a small smile. A soldier grabs my shoulder and sets me aside, and Jesus continues on his slow, painful way up the sloping street. Tears begin to run down my face, and I lift my veil to wipe them away. As I look at my veil, I nearly scream, for there, looking back at me, is the true image of his face. I hold it to my heart and weep.
Even with the help of the man called Simon, he soon falls again. As he does, a great groan goes up from the women, and our keening grows louder. How different he is this day from the day I first encountered him in the temple. I had gone to give my tiny mite into the temple treasury, hoping it could help some other person in need. As I turned from doing this, I found him smiling at me. "Look," he called out to the men with him, "this poor widow's gift is worth far more than all the other contributions, for they gave of their abundance from the money they had left over, while she gave all the money she had from the little she has to live on." At first, I was embarrassed to have all these men looking at me. But then I realized he was not making fun of me, but instead was doing me an honor. I had heard about this man's teachings, but I had been too shy to get near enough to hear him. I had never had time to study very much, and I was afraid I was too stupid to understand this great man's teachings. But as I heard more that day, I realized that many of his teachings were like this. Simple stories of everyday people used to illustrate important points. So I stayed to listen, and listening discovered new depths in myself. That's why, when he fell again, I looked away, unable to bear the sight of his humiliation. This man changed my life. The least I can do is be with him when they take his.
Oh, pastor.
When he painfully pulls himself up from where he has fallen, he sees our grieving group of women. His look causes us to fall silent. When he speaks, his voice, soft with pity, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are those who are childless. Blessed are the wombs that have never given birth, and the breasts that have never nursed.' The words fall among us like burning brands. The crowded narrow street grows quiet as he speaks, and his voice seems to pick up volume as it bounces off the stone walls. Then will they say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us up.' For if this is what they do to the green wood, what will happen when the wood is dry?" "What does it mean?" woman whispers. And I think, "He is the green wood, still alive and with us, and these fools are killing him. If we can do this to this godly man, what hope is there for us when we can no longer see him or touch him or hear him?" And the visions of women burning and girl children going up in smoke fill my horrified eyes, and I fall to my knees, moaning. Around me, the women move on, the sound of their grief washing up like waves against the uncaring walls of the city.
When they arrested Jesus, the men urged us all to go into hiding, fearing the Romans would do a general sweep of the area in an effort to catch all of those who followed him. But his mother refused to leave. Hearing this, I told my husband, Cleopas, to go with the others. I would stay. Cleopas protested, fearing for me. But I told him that I would be safe, for the Romans would never suspect mere women of being dangerous. We agreed to meet later in the upper room of the house where we had shared Passover Seder with Jesus the day before. As I watched Cleopas leave, I realized it was the first time we had been apart in years, certainly since we had decided to follow Jesus. For the past year, we had traveled with him as he taught, watched over him as he slept, marveled at the miracles he performed, and wondered at the things he told us. Most of all, we loved him. Our bond with one another had been strengthened by our bond to him. It is that bond that endangers Cleopas. He's been seen with him too often. But my womanhood renders me invisible to the Romans, to many of my own people as well. Women are simply part of the background, regarded by Jewish and Roman authorities alike as non-persons, unimportant, negligible. We Marys often had talked of this among ourselves and reminded one another that our namesake, the prophet Miriam, also had been thrust into the background. So we know we can stay here in relative safety as long as we don't create too much of an uproar or irritate powerful men. But we are all used to living with such strictures. They are part of being a woman. like water is part of the sea. That's why, as we walk through the streets behind Jesus and the soldiers, our lament rising above the heads of the shoppers and the merchants in their doorways, one part of my brain is busy gauging the reactions of the Romans. Are they getting angry? Are we pushing our luck too far? Deep as my grief is, for his mother's sake, I know I have to stay alert for any change in their mood that might endanger her. Each time he falls, my heart breaks anew. When he came face to face with his stricken mother, I felt as if I was choking on wormwood and gall. And now, just as we approach the city gate, he falls yet again. My heart lurches, for he does not move. Is he dead? Is it over? Hope and grief war in my soul. But then one of the soldiers grabs a bucket from an old woman mopping a shop and pours the dirty water over him. As he stirs, his mother groans. It isn't over yet. He rises and walks unsteadily out through the gate. We follow, walking toward Golgotha.
As we walk through the city gate and onto that dreary hillside, I think I may faint. This cannot be happening. When he fell the third time, I thought, it is over. He is dead. And for a second, a mad hope possessed me. Maybe the suffering could end like this, instead of on that terrible travesty of a tree. My two sons, James and John, had gone away with the other men. But I suspect John will return soon. He will never let Jesus die alone, even if it means risking his own arrest. Both my boys have been with Jesus from the time he called to them while they were mending their nets with my husband Zebedee in our family fishing boat on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. He is their cousin, but we all knew he was something very special. Meant for bigger things than carpentry or catching fish. When I began to understand just how big, I went to him and requested a favor. What do you want? He had asked me. That these sons of mine may sit beside you, one on your right hand and one on your left, when you are in your kingdom. You do not know what you're asking, he said gently. And turning to my sons, he said, can you drink the cup that I will drink? And they replied, yes, we can. So be it, he said, you shall drink my cup, but positions of power are not mine to give. They are awarded by God, our Creator. After that, Jesus often teased my sons, calling them the sons of thunder. Some suppose he's referring to my husband. But our whole family knows he's referring to me, Salome. I am ambitious for my boys, but I also know that wherever this man goes, I want my sons to go. For good or for ill, this is their destiny, and that of my husband and me. And now as I watch him standing on this wind-sipped hill, I'm realizing just how bitter this cup we all must drink will be. I keep remembering him as a little boy, this bright-eyed nephew full of life and joy. His smile would light up the entire house, and his laughter would send us all in a fit of giggles. Now all that laughter is drowning in tears. The Roman soldiers set about their task methodically. Some of them begin preparing the cross, while others strip him of his garments, dividing them among themselves, casting lots for his cloak. His poor, abused body looks so frail as he stands there exposed to the jeers of the crowd. One soldier offers him some wine mingled with gall, but after one taste, he turns his head away. I take his mother's hand, and someone takes mine. It is John, come to be with us at the end.
As I watch them strip him and pull him down onto the cross, I want to shout, "Stop this madness! This is an innocent man, a good man. I know this because he saved my life. I was a maid in the household of an important merchant in Jerusalem and young and foolish. I had been betrothed to a man since I was a child whom I'd never met, but the merchant's son convinced me that he loved me, and I allowed him to come into my bed. His mother found us. She called me an adulteress and locked me in my room. I was terrified. Although the law states that both man and woman should be put to death, my lover was an important man in the community, and I knew nothing would happen to him. But the law says that a betrothed virgin should be stoned to death. At daybreak the next day, they dragged me to the temple. There was a man sitting there surrounded by people, and the temple officials threw me to the ground in front of him. I knew already that I was a dead woman. They said to him, 'Rabbi, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law says that she should be stoned to death. Tell us, what do you say?' I was so confused. Who was this man, and why were they asking him? What were they up to? The man ignored them. He was drawing with his fingers in the dust near my face, but they kept at him and he kept ignoring them. Finally, I calmed down enough to focus on what he was doing. And there in the dust, he had written the unspeakable name of God. What did this mean? The temple officials persisted until he looked up at them and said quietly, 'Let the one among you who has not sinned throw the first stone.' And then he bent back down, drew in the dust some more, smiled sideways at me. One by one, my accusers silently slipped away until he and I were alone. 'Where have they gone?' he asked. I didn't say anything. I just shook my head in bewilderment. 'Does no one condemn you?' 'No, sir,' I replied softly. 'And neither do I,' he said. 'Go now and sin no more.' And he helped me to my feet and smiled and turned me toward the door and gave me a little push and with a smile said, 'Go.' And I did. I went and I got my belongings, and I set out to find the company of Jesus. He had given me back my life, and I would give it to him. And now, these fools want to kill him." I hear a terrible groan from his mother, and I look up. Oh my God, they're not tying him to the cross. They're nailing him to it. My heart feels every blow of that hammer. As they jerk his feet together and begin driving the nails through that precious skin, his body moves convulsively upward, and I fall, driven to the ground by grief.
stretch his naked body out on the cross. Even in this moment of complete vulnerability, he is magnificent. As I look at him through eyes blurred with tears, he is no longer just one man, but seems instead to embody all of suffering humankind. Could any human endure such a burden? I would die in his place without a moment's regret, that they should touch one hair on that adored head, hurt one inch of that beloved body, sickens me with grief and rage. I have loved him forever, it seems, even though I met him only 3 years ago when he was teaching near my home in Magdala. I knew from the moment we first spoke that he had loved me from before I was born. I would have loved him even if he had not cured me of my affliction, taken from me that deep-seated sadness that had clouded my days ever since I had achieved menarche. For me, becoming a woman had meant confinement in a prison of sadness. I seemed always to walk in darkness. I yearned to end this soul-eating pain. Then I met him, and the sun rose in my life. With a glance, he removed the pall of sadness that had dragged my life in the dust. With a touch, he lifted me into a realm of spiritual brightness that dazzled my eyes and delighted my soul. He called me beloved disciple. And when the inevitable rumors began, I went crying to him. He gentled my tears away and said, "Mary, feel my hand on your face. I am touching the image of God. Nothing they say can change that, not in my eyes, and certainly not in the eyes of the one who made you. And know this," he said, "though they may try, they will never be able to cast you into the darkness. My peace is upon you forever. My peace is upon you forever." I cling to those words as they stretch him out upon that dreadful cross. I brush my tears from my eyes and see more clearly what they are about to do. Oh, Holy One, help us. They are nailing him to the cross. I turn to shield his mother from the sight, but it is too late. She lets out a low, guttural sound, like that of a woman in labor. I put my arm around her shoulders and feel her slight body shudder with every blow of that accursed hammer. When they pull the cross upright and drop it into a hole in the rock, I think the jolt will tear his arms from his body. And for a terrible, interminable time, we wait as he slowly weakens. Finally, I hear him give himself to his father. Without looking, I know he is gone from me. And I know if my grief were a river, the whole earth would drown.
Do not call me Naomi, which means pleasant. Call me Mara, which means bitter. For the Almighty has dealt bitterly with me.
As I waited in pain for him to be born, now I wait in pain for him to die. I cannot take my eyes off of him, for every second that passes takes him farther from me. Where is my bright angel now? I would be the God-bearer, the angel said. Well, I did my part, and here he is, this child of God, dying in a dismal, dusty place. Anger washes through me, followed by new waves of grief. For days I've been an ocean, racked by storms of emotion that threaten to drown my soul, kill my faith. This is too much to ask of me, beloved. I believed your promises. I believed them when I pushed him into the world with only Joseph and the animals as midwives. I believed them when the shepherds and the kings came. I believed them when my angel warned Joseph to take us into Egypt. And I believed them when, at the temple, he disappeared. I feared you had already taken him from me then, much too soon. We searched for him for 3 whole days, days like years. When we found him, he said he had to be about your business. But Joseph and I persuaded him to wait a bit longer. And when the time came, it was still too soon by my heart's reckoning. But I had vowed to do your will, and so I helped him any way I could. Many times that meant stepping aside, occasionally it meant helping others to understand, and nearly always it meant biting my tongue when I feared he'd gone too far too fast. But this, oh beloved, is this necessary? Must our child suffer so? We are not worthy of such pain. Take him now before I go mad with rage and pain. But stay, do not take him yet. This is the body of my body, the blood of my blood. I will devour him with my eyes, eating his body, drinking his blood. I will carry him within me forever. The soft summons of mother reaches me as if in a dream. I move as close to his feet as the soldiers will allow. John beside me. Emma, my dying son, says to me, indicating John, behold your son. And to John, he says, behold your mother. His voice is almost too faint to hear. I am thirsty, he rasps, and I turn in silent appeal. The young soldier at the foot of the cross hesitates, and then with a slight shrug, he puts a sponge soaked in cheap wine onto his lance and hoists it up to Jesus. Jesus wets his lips and speaks again, his words tearing into my heart like knives. It is finished. Then he cries out to you, beloved, Abba, into your hands I commend my spirit. He drops his head and his eyes meet mine. And as I watch, the light dies. I hear a scream and wonder who it is. The sky darkens and thunder rumbles and a great silence falls. My body feels numb. It feels as if the darkness lasts forever. After a time, however, light returns. Shaken, the soldiers begin taking my child down from the cross. One of them, a centurion, I think, motions to them to give me the body. I sink down on a rock. With curious gentleness, the soldiers hand him to me, draping him across my lap. I cradle him, my babe now man. His head lolls against my breast and his soft hair strokes my chin. I gently close his eyes. With my veil, I wipe the blood off his face. I have no tears left. My eyes are spent with weeping. My soul is in tumult. My heart is poured out in grief because of the downfall of my people. John says something to me and I look up, my eyes blazing. Do not call me Naomi, which means pleasant. Call me Mara, which means bitter, for the Almighty has dealt bitterly with me. John looks shocked, but what do I care? What are all the prophecies to me now? What do I care for all the fine words of men? My child is dead. Agony forces my head back, and I scream at the heavens, my baby, I want my baby back.
Sorrowful mother, sorrowful mother, all humanity shares your loss.
press my broken son to me as if I can absorb him once again into my body. Oh, beloved, have mercy on me. Pour your tender mercies down upon me and help me. Help me. I have no strength left. And once again, you send my bright angel. I feel the warmth at my back, the angel's hand upon my bent head, and hear the familiar voice. Mary, beloved of all women, do not be afraid, for God is pleased with you. And I remember the promise, all will be well, all manner of things will be well. I allow them to take my son's body from me. They are telling me it is time to prepare him for burial. Salome has brought spices, and Joseph of Arimathea has gotten permission to bury him in his nearby tomb. And so I go through the ancient ritual motions. As I once laid his sweet body tenderly in a cradle, I now lay his broken body tenderly in the tomb. The smell of the sweet herbs fills the air. For one last time, I kiss his mortal face, then gently cover it with a sheet of fine white fabric. My hand caresses the soft cloth, and I smile. Would that I had had such fine cloth to clothe him in while he lived. But I have no bitterness left. My heart already is looking ahead. We walk outside, and James and John push the great stone over the entrance. I stand looking at the tomb. How long, O beloved, how long? And as my dear friends move about me, peace settles on me. I am again one with your will. Let it happen as you say.